Welcome to Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends. The only podcast where it's okay to talk in band. On this podcast, you will be able to hear conversations with some of the greatest names in wind band conducting, composing, and arranging. We'll also visit with great college, high school, middle school, and elementary band directors to get their thoughts on various aspects of being a band director. We'll have regular check-ins with instrument specialists, music dealers, and instrument repair professionals. And if that's not enough, we'll even have regular conversations with Dr. Tim, who will help keep us motivated. That's Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends. And now, here's Charlie.
Welcome to Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends. And today I am proud to bring you my 62nd podcast and number 3 in my 3rd season. It's great to have you joining me for this really informative and insightful conversation with today's guest, Director of the Music Business Program at Indiana State University in Terre Haute, Indiana, Professor Theodore Piechocinski. Ted is one of the most brilliant and talented people I have ever met. And I've met a lot in my 68 years. But Ted Piechocinski is a guy who I met in 1971. And we were even college roommates back in our days at the University of Missouri. Ted is a great musician, a fantastic saxophonist, accordion player, keyboard player, arranger, and he may have some of the best ears of anyone I have ever been around. You're one of those guys who can sit down at a piano and darn near play anything he's ever heard. But more importantly than that, he is a man of great conviction, of great loyalty, and someone who always tries to do the right thing, even when it may not be to his benefit. With degrees in music education, music performance, and a Juris Doctorate, yes, a law degree, and a stint in the Army Band when he was stationed in West Berlin, several years in the law profession and music business world, Ted brings a wealth of experiences to his students and to our conversation. I had so much fun chatting with him, and I know you're going to have a lot of fun listening to my conversation with Professor and one of my best friends, Dr. Ted Piechocinski, right after this message from Kevin Lepper's Advantage Network Percussion.
Are you in the network? Do you get the advantage you deserve? For over 33 years, Kevin Lepper has provided marching shoes and accessories, concert attire and accessories, stick bags for beginners, sticks, mallets, drum heads, percussion ensembles, and so much more through his Advantage Network company. Directors in the know have been working with Kevin for years, and in addition to great products at great prices, they get the advantage of a personal commitment and communication from the man himself, Kevin Lepper. So become a part of the network, Advantage Network. Visit AdvantageNetworkInc.com to learn more. That's AdvantageNetworkInc.com. And don't forget to check out Kevin's slapstick. It's the best one you've ever heard.
Well, my next guest has been a long time in coming, and I should have did this a long time ago. I say that with every guest, but this one for sure. He is a special guy. He is a professor of music and the coordinator and director of the Indiana State University's Music Business Program. And he holds a Juris Doctor. That's a law degree for you people that are not in the know. A Juris Doctor from Cleveland Marshall College of Law. A master's degree in saxophone performance and a bachelor of music education degree. And he is my good buddy, Dr. Theodore Piechocinski. Ted, welcome to the podcast.
Oh, man. Charlie, thanks so much for having me, bud.
Well, for our listeners, some full disclosure here. Ted Piechocinski is one of my closest friends in the world. And we go back to when I met him as a freshman at Northern Michigan University in Marquette, and that would be 1971. So we've remained really close ever since. But that's 51 years, Ted.
Whew, that's scary. Yeah. I remember it well.
Well, listen, we got a lot to talk about, and we got a lot that we're not going to talk about. Let's put that disclaimer out there first. But as I do with most of my guests, please tell us when and where and how you got started in music, Ted.
Well, I grew up in Flint, Michigan.
How was the water back then?
Oh, it was great. No twitches in my body at all. but no, Flint was Flint, and it's always been a struggling sort of town. And I went to, I guess I should go back to where I really got involved in music was two ways. First of all, I'm an old accordion player. I started playing that when I was about 7 or 8, and I took lessons and involved in that kind of stuff. But from a school music standpoint, I did clarinet, had an old silver clarinet that my dad had picked up at a pawn shop, and took that into junior high school, which we had at the time, Longfellow Community Junior High School. My band director was Fred Hopkins, and you know, as music teachers do, one day he said, well, you know, I need a saxophone player. Anybody willing to switch? So yeah, what the heck. And besides, the school had a nicer saxophone than the clarinet I had. So I did that and switched to tenor saxophone. I was, from day one, the loudest person in the band, I promise you. Regardless of instrument, I could outblow anybody as far as volume. We didn't know dynamics. So Fred Hopkins, he was, you know, he took an interest, and he was that influence. So one day, my father was a professional musician, played, well, he was a lounge lizard, is what he was. He played all of the Holiday Inns and all of that kind of stuff in the Midwest, and he was rarely home, and he rarely, as a result, went to any of my music activities. But one time, it worked out that he was able to go to one of my junior high school concerts. I mean, I think he attended two of my performances through my years, so I remember them so distinctly. But he came back home that night and said, you know, I was talking to Mr. Hopkins, and he thinks you'd be a good band director. And it was just like that. You know how this is. These just innocuous comments, boom, they change your life, your destiny. So from that point on, I really didn't think about doing anything else except being a band director. So went on to high school, Flint Northern High School, and did my saxophone thing, always tenor saxophone at this point. And it was one of, I think, four high schools, and active, you know, as schools were active then. We didn't have the competitive schedule that schools do now by any means. But it was a nice program. We had band, orchestra, choir, all that kind of stuff, and an energetic band director who in fact gave me a chance to direct the band, of which I had no idea to do anything. But when he would be out or something, I would be one of his guys for that, and that was sort of cool. He knew of my interest in going to school for it. Anyway, so went through my high school years and all the typical stuff, nothing too outstanding there. Did the solo and ensemble stuff, but my family wasn't one that could afford private lessons anywhere along the way, except for the accordion stuff, in that they didn't pay for that. They had a deal with my accordion instructor because of my dad. There was sort of a trade-off of whatever my dad could offer him. So no lessons, but man, I was enthusiastic. So I don't know if you know this, Charlie, but you know, I was set to go to university at Central Michigan University.
I did not know that.
Yeah, I had applied there and gone to the audition. I remember this so distinctly because it's so embarrassing now. Here I had this audition set up at Central Michigan. And again, I was playing only tenor. Nobody else told me anything different about, well, you know, tenor isn't the thing for real study. So I went and did my audition at Central Michigan, which by then, at that time, was an all-guys marching band, the Chippewas, mm-hmm. I think. So I did my, and I knew so little about auditioning that I auditioned, this is so embarrassing, but I auditioned using the tenor saxophone part for the Holst Second Suite. That was my audition material. Oh my God, how could you do such a dumb thing? But I did it because I didn't know any better. So yeah, I got this conditional admission. That the conditional admission was, you better pick up your game your first year of study or you're done. So that was March. So here came April or May of my senior year. All of a sudden we had this performance at my high school of a visiting saxophone quartet from Northern Michigan University. Just out of the blue, band director had arranged this. I had no idea it was happening. Oh my gosh, that was one of those things. It absolutely turned my plans entirely on their head. As soon as I heard the saxophone quartet, the lead alto was the clarinet / saxophone instructor, Tom Falcone, at Northern Michigan. And I spoke to them, and they had a pianist with him. They did some popish kind of things as well as a classical rep. So the popish things, they had piano, and the piano player was Ron Caviani, who did jazz and composition and theory at Northern Michigan. So I had the chance to meet both of these guys, and I was just absolutely knocked out. And within the next couple of days, I had completely changed my mind and decided I wanted to go to Northern Michigan University, just like that.
Wow. And your high school band director was Gary Stutzman, who was a Northern grad, correct?
Exactly. Yeah. And I put together later that that's why he had the quartet coming in. So they must have been on a tour and needed a stop. So you always go to alums when you're trying to set up those things. And yeah, Gary Stutzman had set that up. So it's just one of those bolts out of the blue that changes the direction of your life. I mean, how often does that happen?
Yeah. So you choose Marquette, Michigan. And I'll bet you one of the things that they did not tell you when the saxophone quartet was there was that the winters are as cold and as brutal as it gets. And in fact, before this podcast interview, Ted, I did some research, and we're talking like February of 2022. They have already had 132 inches of snow. Yes, 11 feet of snow. Now, and it's not still all on the ground, but they probably got 4, 5, 6 feet on the ground there now.
Yeah. And that's how it was. And right. Nobody mentioned that at all. But you and I know that it's absolutely beautiful country. And it was a gorgeous, gorgeous place. And I loved every minute of it.
Yeah. So you had a very diverse set of experiences there. You played in the Wind Ensemble under Lauren Rickmeyer, which was a great group, by the way. I mean, we didn't realize how good it was at the time.
That's right.
You mentioned Ron Caviani with the jazz band. You did the Golden Variety Show Band, the basketball band.
Yeah.
And any other ensemble that needed a saxophone player. But you were also involved in a group called the Fantastics, which I was honored to be a part of your second year. So talk about that a little bit.
Well, the same year I went to Northern Michigan, it was also the first year for yours and mine, very good friend and brother, Tim Lotzenheiser. He had just come out of his master's program at Alabama, University of Alabama, and before that with his great experience, undergrad experience at Ball State University. So this was his first gig teaching university, so he was the percussion guy and the marching band guy, and man oh man, he was going to come in there and make a difference, which happened from day one. When he had been at Ball State, he'd been involved as the drummer for a great, what did they call him? I'm not sure if they called it a swing choir, show choir, that Ball State was quite known for at the time. So Tim took that model and brought it to Northern Michigan. They'd never had anything like this before. I think there were 8 vocalists, 4 guys, 4 girls, and piano, bass, drums, and I was the all-around hanger-on guy playing some woodwind stuff. And I ended up doing a few arrangements and lifts and that kind of thing for the group. I was never a singer, thank goodness,
or a dancer. You sang some.
Oh, in a couple of extreme cases, but I would not put singer on my resume at all. So, but with that group, oh my gosh, it was just such an amazing experience. That was by far the most publicly exposed group that we had at Northern Michigan University. It gained a reputation as an entertaining group, and it was these were really good people in this. These singers, they just took right into it, and it was a neat show package. And in fact, let's see, later on, we did a USO tour. I'm not sure what year was that, 72 or 73?
That would have been 72. Yeah, my 72. First year in the group.
Oh, okay. We did a 3-week tour, I think?
28 days in the Caribbean.
Yeah.
In February.
Which was wonderful. So how many performances did we do? They flew us by helicopter and traveled by trucks. It was just an amazing experience. We did a lot of shows within that time and had some fantastic experiences. And it was just super. But that was a popular group in the region, for sure. Yeah. And we did some stuff lower part of the state as well, and into Wisconsin. But what an experience. Oh, my gosh. Yeah.
Well, then on year three of your third year, second year, Tim Lotzenheiser, who was our marching band director and directed the Fantastics, takes a job at the University of Missouri Columbia as a director of percussion studies and assistant director of bands.
Right.
And you transfer with him in the middle of the night. So tell me about that. We've never talked about this.
Oh, man. That was one of those things. I remember, I think maybe Tim had called me or something. And this was fair, maybe July, something like that. Tim called me, which was, wow, in those days, who's Mr. L is calling me? Oh, my goodness. So he called to tell me that he had taken a new job in Missouri, and just wanted to let me know rather than hearing it from somebody else. And I'm not sure what language I used. He'll have a much better recollection of this. But my response was, I'm going too. I'm transferring. I just made the decision on the spot that if that's where he's going to go to continue his work. He was such an influence, an amazing influence in so many ways, musically and as a human being. There was no question I was going to go to Missouri. Never thought of any ramifications. And in fact, when I made that, here's this grand decision, and I went and spoke with my mother about it. I think my dad was on the road. I didn't discuss it. I said, here's what I've decided I'm going to do. And she said, oh, that's great. Well, guess what? You're going to be paying for it. So figure that out. Because here I was going into my senior year, right? So I would have been done. I would have had my music ed degree. So with this decision, they were fine with it, but I was going to do what I needed to do, and I would foot the bill. They were wonderful about it, so it was the great thing for them to do. So, yeah, I transferred just like that to Mizzou. Holy cow, huge change of circumstance, big school. What was Northern Michigan at the time? Maybe 13,000, 14,000?
Oh, no, about 5,600, maybe 6,000.
Was it really that small?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here, went to Mizzou, and what, you go into a 30,000 environment or something like that? Big time. But I just loved it from the get-go. It was big time excitement, and the music program. I don't want to say it was better than Northern Michigan, because as you said a few minutes ago, our musical experience at Northern Michigan was tremendous. It might have been a small school, but oh my gosh, our groups were serious contenders, and we had great musicians and our leadership, starting with Dr. Rick Meyer and Ron Caviani. It was tremendous.
But yeah,
it was
I agree.
It was a different ball game at Missouri. What was it then? Big 8? Big 12? What was it?
Well, it was a Big 8 then.
Big 8 at that point.
The Big 8,
so jumped into it. And I certainly had other saxophone players to contend with. And it was quite, quite a different experience, but loved it from day one. So I did that. I finished my degree in 2 years, and it was wonderful.
Yeah, I hung back at Northern.
Yeah.
And for one semester.
One semester.
And then before I killed the band director who replaced Tim, I think the chairman of the music department, Dr. Wright, called Tim and said, will you please get this guy out of here because he's going to kill the program up here. So I transferred to Missouri, and then we had just a great time. But one of the fun times, you know, in the summers, Tim would set up these marching band camps all over the place. And we would go and do marching band camps as we were learning our crafts. And we'll talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. But those were some wild times. I mean, we drove all night working bands from 8 in the morning until 9 o'clock in the evening. We'd do a planning meeting on Sunday. We would do that Monday through Friday. We'd get done about noon on Friday. And then we would drive like 500 miles and do it again. We maybe catch a drum corps show in the middle and just keep going. What the heck were we thinking during that time?
We were too dumb to know that it was a dumb thing to do. It was incredible, but what an experience. And you're right, that was that schedule. And it's not like we were taking 2-hour breaks in the afternoon to let the kids go to the pool or anything like that. There wasn't a bit of downtime. If we didn't have the band on the field or in a full band rehearsal, we broke them out in sectionals. We worked our tails off, and we worked the kids' tails off. But in that time, we took them from fundamentals to a finished show, right?
In a week.
Yeah. And then scrambled out of there, and like you say, got ready for the next one. And it wasn't always the same show. We weren't walking in with canned shows. We were tailoring it to those bands. Oh my gosh, we worked hard, and we worked those kids hard. But how much fun was that? That was fantastic experience.
And the greatest training we could have ever asked for.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. Even when we were at Mizzou, well, you and I and a couple of our buds, we would go out again with Tim. He'd arrange these like evening seminars, sectionals with various bands. So we might jump in the car at the end of our academic day and drive two and a half hours to some small school in Missouri, work for 2 hours with sectionals and all of that stuff, grab some food and get back to campus at midnight, ready to do it all again the next day. But amazing experiences. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Well, we had a great run together at Missouri, and then you graduate. And the next thing I remember is that I'm sitting in our good friend Les Taylor's living room in Muncie, Indiana in the summer. I guess I was working Jim Patton's Madison Heights High School band and taking a summer class with Earl Dunn or something. And all of a sudden you pop in and you say, well, I just come by to say goodbye, guys. I just enlisted in the Army. And our jaws hit the floor. And you know, I never asked you about it, but what brought that all about?
I've been always sort of a wild card in some ways, for sure. Going back to my mother's reaction to my changing schools, that was sort of one of those wild cards in my life too. But that's always been there. I was that summer. Well, several summers I had worked actually as Lester's copyist. Back in the days before we had, you know, software and those kind of things, Lester was and is a tremendous composer and arranger, and he was so busy that he would give me his pencil scores that he was working on for summer bands, and I would write up the individual parts. So he'd give me a score in the afternoon, and I would work them overnight into parts that he could then send to the bands the next day. So that was also a great experience. So, in the midst of that, here I was. I wasn't sure what I was going to do. I didn't think I was ready to go out and do a high school band because I didn't know where I wanted to land. And something spurred me to look at the Army. I just don't know what, and it wasn't any wild drinking binge or anything of the sort. I just got this into my head that I wanted to go out and travel. I needed some space. So In fact, I did my Army audition at Fort Ben Harrison in Indianapolis, which wasn't far from Muncie, where Lester was.
Tell me you didn't play the tenor saxophone part to Holt's Second Suite on that one.
No, by that time, I had been forced to do the switch to alto, thank goodness, at Northern Michigan. So no, I did the typical audition where you go in and sight read your tail off and hope you do a good enough job in so many different genres. So I was fortunate in that regard. And back then, you could choose. Of course, being a college graduate, I had somewhat of an advantage, but you could choose where you wanted to be posted as long as they had an opening or a projected opening down the road. And I knew I just wanted to get away. And I knew that I wanted to go to Europe. So I asked for being posted with the West Berlin band, the 298th Army band, and they looked it up, and yep, they projected that they would have an opening by the time I was finished with my training, and I was guaranteed a spot in West Berlin. So that's how that worked out. Then I had to go to the Army and Navy School of Music in Norfolk, Virginia. That program is typically 6 months. You learn the music part of the Army experience, the Navy experience. But because of my degree, and I was a pretty good sight reader and that kind of stuff. I wasn't a virtuoso, but I got around okay. I didn't have to stay as long. I think I only had to stay the minimum of 2 months at Norfolk. So I got to West Berlin. And that's where I was for the next 2.5 years, playing with that Army band, which was a fantastic experience. From your exposure to service bands and people who've done it, that you do everything. You might do a combo gig in the morning, a marching gig in the afternoon, and then a concert band gig in the evening. You never know what's going to come up, so we had to be ready to do all those things. And it was tremendous. Can't say enough about it. It was a great experience. And I was able to use my arranging chops and experience at that point to become the arranger for the band when they needed something special. So that was fun. That got me a little bit bigger of a workspace in the barracks we had in West Berlin. But it was fantastic, fantastic opportunity. And to travel around Europe playing in a different, many different settings, just great.
So take us from West Berlin, Germany, to your first high school teaching job at Homestead High School in Fort Wayne, Indiana.
Well, first, when I got out of the Army, I felt to get my master's degree, because at that point, having a master's degree was still the highly suggested thing to do in the band world, the high school world, even though that's significantly less of a push now. So I wanted to go to grad school, and by that time I was playing so much saxophone that I wanted to concentrate on playing in a different level than I had before. So when I got out of the Army, I actually went to New Mexico State University and got my master's in saxophone performance. So that was the next, three semesters. And then I was the search for the first teaching gig. So my first teaching gig was at a small high school in Ohio, Valley View High School in Germantown, Ohio. And wouldn't you know, my luck was, when I went into that, I was very fortunate to get the job. But wouldn't you know, the time I chose to get that job was at a time when the funding for schools was always subjected, I'm not sure if it is in Ohio now, but it was always subject to votes on increases for taxes to support schools. So I went into Valley View at a time when they didn't get the levy passed that they needed. So the school board essentially had said, look, if we don't get this passed, then we're going to have to cut athletics, extracurriculars. The community maybe didn't believe it, but the school board followed through on it because the levy failed. So I walked into this band situation, very enthusiastic, and there was no extracurricular. we had to be out of the school at 2:30 in the afternoon to make the point even more. So we had no activities, no athletics, no marching band, even though the band had a long tradition of doing a marching band festival. So we were able to get that done. So I was able to put together one show with my band, even though we weren't allowed to practice on campus. We had to go to a park and put that show together. Because again, the school board was trying to make a point. So by that time, I knew of another job opening in Fort Wayne, Indiana, Homestead High School. So as much as I enjoyed the kids at the situation in Ohio, gosh, there was no telling when that dire financial situation was going to lift. So I said, I've got to take a chance on this Fort Wayne thing. So I did, interviewed, and I got it. So it was Homestead High School, which now, for anybody in the Midwest, people know that Homestead High School is a force of a band. Certainly in Indiana, but around the Midwest as well. Fantastic band. That's not what we had at the time. Fort Wayne has a great reputation of public school education, but in those public schools, Homestead was the small puppy compared to the other ones. It was outlying. It was Southwest Allen County, so it was much smaller school, much smaller enrollments, and not as much money. So I had 4 years there. I enjoyed it very, very much, but we were not as competitive as the other schools in the area. As it turns out, I think the year or two after I left, General Motors decided to build a truck assembly or motor assembly plant in Southwest Allen County, a half a mile from the school, and it suddenly exploded in its growth and in its tax structure, and that school just absolutely exploded into a much, much bigger school. The enrollment had to increase 3 or 4 times within the next couple of years. But by that time, I was gone, so I just knew about it. Being in Indiana, I'm very aware of Homestead High School now, and they're a great, great program and right up there. So that was that adventure.
So what was the next step after Homestead?
Well, after being at Homestead, I mean, I really enjoyed it, every minute of it, and we had all of the typical stuff going, the marching and the concert band and the jazz band and all that stuff. I felt it was clicking very well, but again, this restless guy in me had this other idea about, oh man, what am I going to do? Am I going to be okay with this 20 years from now? So I started to think about that kind of a future, and it's like, I love music. I always have loved music, and that never wavered. I loved the education part, but I just sort of had this gnawing feeling, and I just knew, gosh, I like some wild cards in my life, so maybe I better explore something new. And I didn't want to go into fundraising or that kind of stuff. I needed something a little bit more challenging. So perhaps because of my experience being in West Berlin in the 70s, which, you know, as you well know, was what, 100, 150 kilometers inside Eastern Europe, it was sort of a precarious place. But that got me very interested in, simple things like freedom and what it means, and free will and democracy and those kind of things. So I think that planted a seed in my head about doing right in other ways. So I decided that, well, maybe a legal career. Talk about right-hand moves or 90-degree moves. I said, yeah, maybe a legal career. And maybe I can combine that with my education background. So, yep, here's Ted again telling my family and young daughter at the time, guess what? We're not going to do this anymore. I've decided to go to law school without much consultation with other people, which is always such a popular move. So I went to law school, not knowing how I was going to pull this off, but at this point I'm a little older guy, not your traditional law student, and oh my goodness, it was hard going to law school for sure. But I knew, you know, I'm going to be stubborn in that regard. I'm not going to quit. So I worked my way through it and ended up figuring out how to do this hardcore academic stuff, and came out of that real well. But then I get my law degree, and it's like, okay, now what are you going to do? Nobody's going to come knocking at my door to offer me a position in the music business, because I have this educational background and music background and now this law background. No, that's not how it works at all. So I started in probably in my third year making inquiries, sending out letters, snail mail about, I've got all these things. Would you be interested? And I still have my file of rejections. Oh, your qualifications look good, interesting, but no, we don't have anything that fits your qualifications. So anyway, I went out and did a real legal job. I was an assistant director of law for the city of Cleveland for almost 5 years. And that was extremely interesting also, getting in all sorts of big time municipal law situations. I was dealing with some of our 26 labor unions that we had, and in those, all those interesting fights, litigation, and really interesting. But I always wanted to get into the music business, so I kept writing letters and making new contacts. Finally, long story short, I had the chance to go to a publishing company in New York called Cherry Lane Music Publishing. They were a very active straight ahead music publisher, and they had a strong print publishing division doing music folios and sheet music and that kind of thing. So I was given the opportunity to head up the print division. So my gosh, so all of a sudden I'm in New York. The offices at first were a little bit outside of New York, but I was in New York so often that I had a great chance to jump into all of that activity. Later on, we moved the offices into New York. So I did the whole Connecticut to New York commute every day and did all of that stuff. It was amazing. So I was able to choose the groups that we were going to go after for representation and then chase after them. So it was a lot of travel, a lot of negotiation, a lot of contract drafting, because I brought that in-house. So it was such an exciting time. Very hard on a family life, because I was not home very much. And that didn't bode well, but oh my gosh, it's what I had worked for years.
Any funny stories or not so funny stories of artists you met along the way?
Well, we represented some top people. My gosh, probably the strongest one we had was, and our bestseller was, Metallica. Here we are representing Metallica in all sorts of music folios, transcribing exactly what every instrumentalist in that group did. And we did piano vocal folios of all of their albums, and it was great. And again, they were our best seller. One of the things I remember most being impressed by, and I met a lot of the folks that we dealt with along the way, but one of the stories that always hangs with me, and I still tell it to my music students now, how important it is to be involved in every aspect of your career and what's going on with your business. Metallica, again, huge group, still are. They were on one of their tours. I can't remember which album they were promoting at the time, but they were performing at Madison Square Garden, and this is the one where one of their guys made an entrance through a rig from the ceiling down to the stage, and it was just crazy. So here's Madison Square Garden. So we had arranged, because their books were our absolute best sellers, we had arranged to present them with our version of golden discs, except these were books and frames and nicely done. So we were able to get in to see the whole group a few minutes before, make the presentation and all that kind of stuff. So I remember just so distinctly having a few minutes with Lars Ulrich, the drummer, and this is 5 minutes before they're going on this stage in front of tens of thousands of rabid fans. Here's Lars Ulrich and myself having this conversation. His question was, what's the international skew of sales of our books? 5 minutes before he goes out. So it blew me away, and I had to make up a number really fast. I hope it was sort of accurate. But that always stuck with me, that here are these guys, they are smart, And they are not just about one thing. They kept their eyes on all of the plates they had spinning. So that was fun. So, there were some certainly situations I had where artists might not have been happy with the product for one reason or another. So I had to learn some very quick diplomacy in diffusing those kinds of situations. But it was a great time.
That's great. So from Cherry Lane, you moved on to a couple other companies, but I want to get to your current position as a director of the music business program at Indiana State. So when did you start there?
Yeah, this is going back to 2004 now. I was working at a publisher in Florida, FJH Music Publishing, great in the band and orchestra world especially. I was doing business affairs and personal kinds of issues for them. And it's still a very good company and had great times there. But I was restless to get back to the Midwest primarily. And I wanted something that was going to be more sustainable in the long run. So I became aware of this job opening at Indiana State University. And my gosh, the job description, they wanted somebody with an educational background, somebody who had business chops, and somebody who had music experience. It was like this job description was written just for me. So I made my investigation and decided that, yeah, this puts all of these pieces of my life and experience together. And I applied for it. In fact, I don't know if we've talked about this, but the first search they had done for the position was a failed search. So when that happens, you go back to the drawing board entirely in academia, and you start absolutely fresh, new pool of candidates. It's at that point that I became aware of the job opening. So I put my stuff in, and wouldn't you know, it just fell into place, and I was offered the position, and boom, there I was again in the Midwest, finding my way in the academic world. But it was and is fantastic. I mean, it's truly been the culmination of everything that I've done, even going back to Northern Michigan University and all of those elements. It combines everything. So I hope I'm able to help my students in different ways in saying, look, I'm not showing you this stuff from what a book says. I'm telling you, I've lived a lot of these experiences, good and bad. So we talk about it. I try not to take up too much time with war stories, but I do want them to know that it's different. The field is different from what we learn in the lab.
Well, we hear about music business programs, and I was looking at your website, and you got two different tracks. You got a music business administration, and that's a concentration, right? And then you got a music merchandising concentration. Is that correct?
It is. That's correct. Yeah.
But what's the big difference between those two?
Well, it's not really a huge difference. The students do 8 business courses, 8 College of Business courses. And it's important when I'm talking to prospective students and their parents that these are business courses that business students take. It's not watered down courses for, you know, those music students. No, these are business courses. So between economics, intro to marketing and management. So everybody takes a core of 5 courses in straight business, 2 kinds of economics and accounting principles. The other 3 courses, that's where the track difference comes into mind. The other 3 courses for the administration track, they are 3 strictly hardcore business management courses. And for the merchandising track, they are 3 hardcore marketing classes. Maybe it's more accurate to call it a marketing concentration, but it doesn't matter. So that's the real difference. So I think the kids are, and I always tell kids to, you know, even though you might sign up for one over the other, relax, you're okay. You've still got the fundamentals. You're going to be flexible enough to do anything, or at least to learn what you need to know in anything. So at that point, it's really a matter of what sounds more interesting to them at the time. And by the time they make that decision, you know, they're juniors, so they're looking to get this finished So it's either, do you like more marketing courses or more management courses?
So when a kid enrolls at Indiana State or any university music business program for that matter, what do you think the percentages of them that have their mind made up that I want to be a music business major? That's what I want my major to be when I walk in the door.
It's really interesting phenomenon. In fact, percentages, I think easily 50 to 60% of the majors know that, or at least think they know that that's what they want to do. But I think interestingly that other percentage, that 40%, that's from kids, basically performance and music ed people who become, I don't want to say disillusioned, but who say, okay, maybe that's not what I thought it was after all, so let's turn to this other thing. I still love music and I still want to be involved. So, gosh, maybe the music business thing allows me to combine it all, which in fact it does. One of the things that drew me to Indiana State was the fact that all of our music business students are musicians first. They've got to do all of the stuff that music students do, lessons, theory, history, ensembles. They do all of that stuff. So they know what it is to live the life of a musician. On top of that, they do the music business stuff. So I like that. And there are a lot of schools, music business programs around the country who are not even based in music schools. They might be in management programs or even sports management programs, and that's fine. There are some great programs in all of those. I'm not dissing any of those, but I was particularly drawn because I like the fact that students are going to know music and know what it's like to be a musician when they're facing whatever their challenges are. So yeah, I get students later on, especially, my gosh, even into their junior and senior years, who say, you know, Dr. P, I'd like to switch majors. And they've got some catching up to do, but I've had some fantastic majors come out of precisely that kind of switch. Oh my gosh, some great, great business people.
Well, you know, when we go to college to be a music major, come out of a high school program, we really have no idea of the workload or the time commitment that it really does take. I mean, it's one of the most labor intensive undergraduate programs I can think of if you do it right. I mean, it's just crazy. So
yes, it is.
Yeah. You know, I feel some students are sitting there in their high school music programs, band program, choir, orchestra, and they don't have any idea that a music business program happens, that it's out there for them. And I think every music teacher should let their students know about this avenue for a career while they're in high school. I mean, because, you know, besides the number of band and orchestra choir kids, there are masses of students who love music in schools who are not playing in an organized ensemble. They're probably playing guitar, drums, or whatever in a rock band or a garage band or whatever they call them these days. And they don't realize it's something they could study.
Absolutely. And it's sort of tricky to make them aware of it. You know, we put out materials and we contact people, but especially, you know, as we all know, it's been a different ball game of exposure since March of 2020. We're all figuring out how to get by day, let alone get into high schools and tell them about us. It's very difficult.
So talk about your placements. You got some graduates doing some pretty neat things. Brag a little bit.
Well, we want to also concentrate kids, push to kids that, you know, this isn't about one thing. We tell me your dreams, and then let's see what we can do. There was a time when the easiest part of the music industry to get into was music merchandising, which is still a fantastic opportunity for sure. But I also had a lot of kids saying, I like the record business, I like management, I like music manufacturing. So I want to know where their interests are. So yeah, we've had kids placed in music publishing. I've got a former student or one of our graduates who is in fact in charge of the Pacific Rim sales for Conn-Selmer. That's a huge assignment. I've got several kids at the biggest online merchandiser there is, Sweetwater Music, up in Fort Wayne. I've had kids doing artist management. So tell me what you like to do, and then let's go about it. It's a search, and nothing is handed to any of us, let alone our students, so we have to help them through the search. But it's about discovery.
Yeah. Well, you're also an author, having written a book, which I'm holding in my hand here. I wish our listeners could see it right now, which I like to call The Definitive Guide to the Music Industry. But I guess we'll go with your title. It's called The Music Industry, Where Creativity Meets Business. And you published it in 2020.
Yeah.
And you know, Ted, I think this is something that every high school library or band room or orchestra room or choir room needs to have sitting around so kids can see the breadth of it and the expanse of it. Teachers get a copy of this?
Well, it is published through Northeastern Music Publications. A guy by the name of Dr. Randy Navarre, a great musician, great writer. He's done a lot in the band world and jazz ensemble. He published it, and they are exclusively represented by Theodore Presser. So if you go on their site, it is certainly available there. A great experience, but I thank you for the plug. I really do. But I especially want to stress that at Randy's encouraging, I included quite a substantial chapter just on the business of music education. And I think that's one of those areas that we sometimes neglect in our music ed programs, that when a person walks into a band program as a new band director, they're not just waving a baton. They are also jumping into their own business with its personnel concerns, certainly with its budget and handling money. I'm thinking back to my time as a high school band director, I knew nothing about that stuff. I just wanted to wave a baton and make music. So I've taken a lot of time in that module of the book to hopefully help music teachers realize that you've got to know about this stuff too. You know, you and I both know the expression, and we've talked about it many times, that the older we get, the less we know, and the more questions there are. I don't see that as a bad thing. That's a wonderful thing. That's what keeps us going and growing and curious. So that's the kind of thing I want to do with this book. It's not, I appreciate you saying it's definitive, but I wish it were, but it's not, because it can't be definitive, but it starts the discussion going, and it gives some broad strokes, fundamental things, guidelines about a variety of chapters and issues. But it opens the door to talking about it and finding out where the extra answers are.
Yeah, I think students would really love to read this, and I think teachers would really love to read this.
So. I would love that they would love it.
Well, you got a lot of chapters in the book. I mean, you deal with copyright and music publishing and the record industry and contracts and marketing and arts administration, concert promotion, like you mentioned, the business of music education. You do a whole thing on professionalism and you know, you even talk about the music entertainment industry of tomorrow. So what do you think the music entertainment industry is going to look like in 10 years?
It's a wild canvas right now. Who can tell? But, you know, in fact, I'm teaching a class right now, a seminar kind of class on the record business and music publishing. And we've been talking about this a lot already in our first couple of weeks of class. Like, where is it going to be? It's certainly in a state of flux right now. But then the more you look back, especially the entertainment business has always been in a state of flux. It is always changing. There's something new happening all the time, whether it's technology oriented that makes us change, or if it's ownership issues that people become more aware of. I think creators today are much more aware of the fact that they do not have to give up ownership. That used to be the price of admission in order to get those contracts and those opportunities to get your product out there. But with whether it's self-publishing or in the recording business, the opportunity to create your own business, on SoundCloud or any of the other opportunities to get your stuff out there. We're not as dependent on the big companies, because they would be the, you know, they'd give you the blessing of whether you're going to have the chance to be big or not. Oh my gosh, that's not the case now. You can make a go of it. What I think happens now is, it used to be a home run ball game. We would hope, by signing you as a publisher or a record company, that you would hit home runs for us. And in those businesses, of course, it means the hits. Now, I think we're switching to a small ball game, where you don't need home runs. If you're hitting base hits, doubles, triples, you can still, yeah, I hope that analogy works, but I'm just stuck on it lately, but I think it's really appropriate for what the business is changing to. You can have a great career and do great business by not having those huge monster hits, which, by the way, are becoming further between, even for the major artists.
You think the digitization and the digital downloads completely changed the whole business?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. The record business, of course, had its head in the sand for years until Napster blew it out of the water in 1999, when all of a sudden the old model of here's what we'll put on the shelves for you to decide whether you want to buy it or not, that model was completely blown by peer-to-peer sharing of digital files. Looking back, of course, they should have done this, but they were not ready for that. Even though digitization had been around since the early mid-80s with CDs, we didn't put those next pieces together. And when it did explode, it took the industry years and years to recover from it, which they're still doing.
Yeah. Well, I know one of your areas of expertise is copyright.
Yeah.
And this is something that so many in our field, I mean, they don't understand, or they just choose to ignore, I think. But it's really nothing more than stealing. Don't you agree?
Charlie, I'm still a lawyer, and I can't agree to such leading questions. stealing is such a broad term. Thanks, though. Thanks. You made me sweat a little bit there.
Okay, well, let's go this way. You know, I think there's probably a listener or two that have broken a copyright law. Let's say, you know, they've copied extra parts for their band.
Yep.
Yeah. Now, I've never done that, and I know you have never done that.
Never did it. No.
And their rationale is, you know, I don't have the budget to buy another set. So if I'm a teacher, how can I have that conversation with my administrator or department chairman to begin to educate them on why doing their best to follow copyright laws is so important?
Yeah, and it is so critical, and I thank you for bringing it up. This whole process, this cycle of creation and getting works out there to consumers, and consumers deciding whether or not they like it. Music business, like any other business, works on this life cycle. So if any one of those three steps falters along the way, then things fall apart. So creators, we assume most creators are doing it because they want to be benefiting from it financially. So they want to get their stuff out there. They want it to be liked. So publishers are the ones that typically get the stuff out there. Consumers tell us whether they like or don't like something by how much they access it or buy it. So if we're disrupting that, why should creators create as much? Why should publishers publish as much if they're not getting that third part, the benefit of their work? Publishers spend huge amounts of money trying to get the word out about things they represent. So if it's all part of this cycle, and absolutely, music teachers are part of this cycle. They are a strong body of consumers. They have the right to say, yes, we're going to buy this. No, we're not going to buy this. So they are absolutely a part of this chain, an important part. And that's one of the big reasons I did that module, too, is I want music teachers to realize that they're not on the outside looking in. They are part of this puzzle, this mechanism, this ecosystem that works. So the moment they they do something that they're not supposed to do, like copying parts without authorization, well, they're cheating the system. And yeah, we all know, my gosh, when I was a high school band director, at first I had a $200 buying budget one year. $200, you can't do much with that, and I couldn't do much with it then. But we had to make do because of the situation. I borrowed from friends who had legitimate copies, and that's perfectly okay. So back to your question about what a teacher can do. They can lay this out to their administrators. Look, you don't want us to do things that we're all ashamed of, and certainly you, the school, don't want to do or don't want to authorize something that puts us in jeopardy. But we can't do our job as music teachers unless we have the resources. So I need you to help me out. And these days there are plenty of places that a teacher can point to an administrator and say, look, it's not just me. And I will point out, yeah, it'd be great if everybody bought the book and they read that stuff. But even more than that, NAFME does a great job of presenting copyright materials, or how to deal with copyrighted materials in the school music context. They really have a great resource gallery of these things. Music for All has a great collection of music copyright resources. So the music teacher never should feel like they're alone. The trick is, music teachers cannot play dumb and say, oh, I didn't know. And you and I probably know people along the way who have just played the innocent role and said, oh, I just didn't know any better. I thought this was okay. No. You've got to be smarter than that. And by the way, we've also got to be able to look our kids in the eye and say, here's the deal with copyright. Oh, forget those Xeroxed copies in your folder. You can't do that. Kids are smart these days. They know what's going on. So we've got to be able to say to our students, we're doing the right thing, because in the future it's important that you do the right thing too, regardless of what your future is. It's setting the table to do the right thing.
That's great advice. That's great. So Ted, as you look back at your career, and you've had so many experiences to look back on, what are some of the things that you've learned that you carry with you to this day?
Oh man. This is a great question for sure. Number one that comes on the list is, and this isn't old, I mean, this isn't new stuff, but this is the power of relationships. You and I both know, we've had conversations through the years about the power of relating to people, whether it's workers or employees or students or whatever. That strength of dealing with a person one-on-one, it can help us, it can hurt us if we don't do it the right way. There is no substitute for relationships. We like to deal with people who we like, right? Because it shows that person is a good judge of character. Right? It's all about egos, yes, but all of this is predicated on the fact that we're all good people and we want to do all of the good things for all of the right reasons. It's not about using people. It's recognizing that everybody has something to offer to us. So the power of relationships, absolutely number one. Secondly, I think what I would put on my list is this idea of curiosity. We have to remain curious in our minds. We have to want to know that thing that comes across our desk, but I don't know anything about that. Let me look into that. However far afield that is, I think that keeps our thought process fresh. I think it keeps us fresh as people. We don't want to become stale in any part of our lives. So to stay curious and humble that we do not know everything, and that we value those people who do have the ability to show us something else, that's all part of it. We have to be good people. And that's not always easy to stick to these days, but extremely important.
Ted Piechocinski, this has been fantastic. And this has been the best conversation we had since our days in Marquette, Michigan, where we go for some pie and coffee over at the Big Boy there. Remember those?
We solved all the world's problems, didn't we?
We did most of them, I can tell you buddy. But hey, thanks so much for taking time to being with me on the podcast. I know our listeners are going to love this. The book is called The Music Industry, Where Creativity Meets Business, from Northeastern Music Publishing. Can they get it on Amazon too?
I don't believe so on Amazon, because Amazon, they demand such a premium that this isn't a big time publishing thing. They don't have those kind of margins to mess with. So I think he kept it off of Amazon for that reason.
But they can find it.
Absolutely. Theodore Presser. It's available through Theodore Presser.
That's why Theodore Piechocinski.
How about that? TP? That is not my company. Charlie, thank you so much for having me. This has been so much fun. I appreciate it.
Ted Piechocinski nailed it. In the end, the important thing is our ability to create and sustain relationships with people. I remember reading a book many years ago, and this analogy will date me. But the businessman Harvey McKay, he was an envelope entrepreneur from the Minneapolis area, wrote a book. And in it, he said, "He who has the biggest Rolodex wins." Now, for those of you too young to remember what a Rolodex was, it was a desk tool that allowed you to organize all your contacts and business cards. So Ted's emphasis about the power of relationships is spot on. And when he also pointed out the importance of curiosity, well, I can tell you, Ted Piechocinski is one of the most curious people I have ever met. And as I recently read, learning starts with a question. And though we may never figure out the answer, we will learn much as we try to seek it. Ted, we need to meet somewhere for some pie and coffee, just like we did on a regular basis during our college days. There's a lot of world's problems, buddy, we got to solve. We didn't know how lucky we were back then, but there is one thing I do know. I am lucky and blessed to call you my friend, my brother. Take care, pal. I love you. Well, that's Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends. Thanks for taking time to join us, and I'll be back with more great conversations. Please tell your friends about Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends, available on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen to your favorite podcast. So until the next time, this is Charlie Mangini saying, thanks for listening.
Thanks for listening to Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends. If you would like to send a question to Charlie or have a comment, please send an email to bandtalkcharlie@gmail.com. We hope you will let your colleagues, students, and friends know about Band Talk with Charlie Mangini and friends. Thanks for joining us, and we look forward to being with you again soon.